Have you ever felt like your dysfunction disqualifies you from enjoying all of the fun stuff about Christmas? That's what we're going to be talking about today at oneChurch.tv.
What is up, One Church? We are so excited that you decided to join us online today. If you are new with us, text NEW1C to 97,000. That will get you connected to our social media, everything One Church. Now, we're about to start off our service with a time of worship.
Well, good morning, One Church. We are ready to start worshiping with you all this morning. We invite you to stand and sing with us as we begin together today. We're so glad you're here.
I would be desperate without your love, slave to the darkness if it wasn't for the cross. You have won me with your kindness, chase me down when I lost. Where would I be if it wasn't for the cross? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was in prison, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my Jesus, I was in prison, now
Rumors of the Son of Man, stories of a Savior, holiness with human hands, treasure for the traitor. No ear is heard, no eye is seen. The image of the Father, until heaven came to live with me. A rescue like no other. You are
you are worthy.
And now we're going to continue our time of worship through our giving. If you've never given before, there are several ways to give, and they're shown on the screen now. And it is through your generosity that we can lead people to a growing relationship with Jesus. Now, we have a couple of announcements. On Christmas Eve, we will have our night of worship. It's going to be at 2111 Trenton Road at 4 p.m., and you cannot miss it. And then on January 2nd, we will have our Manna Cafe Mobile Pantry. And we will have more details to follow. Just make sure you follow us on all our social media outlets.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time. Yes, the most wonderful time. Oh, the most wonderful time.
Do you have any crazy Christmas stories? You know, Christmas time is typically full of adventure and wild stories in my family. There was one Christmas where the amount of presents and when we were going to open them just caused an insane amount of drama for us. Really took a lot of the fun out of Christmas morning. There was one time where my family and I, we went out of town, left Tennessee, and came back to find our house completely ransacked and so many things stolen. It was not the best Christmas time for us then. And it's not all bad and drama for us either. We've got some fun Christmas stories. There was the one time where a week before Christmas, Jamie and I, we spent time in the Eastern Caribbean. I mean, I love the snow and I love cold weather, but I'm just telling you, there's nothing like the week before Christmas on Maho Beach in St. Martin, right? That's such a cool time. The story of Christmas itself is full of pretty crazy stuff when you dig deep into it. When you think about it, wise men, big star, shepherds and angels, the virgin birth, the King of Kings born next to a bunch of smelly animals. That seems crazy when you really, really think about it. If you're not a Christ follower, you know, Christmas is one of those times where you're, you know, in your head, you're like, cool story, bro, but whatever. Like, I'm not buying it, right? Highly unlikely. Look, I get it. When you read the Christmas story, there's a lot in there that just makes you scratch your head. And as we've learned so far in this series, Christmas appears to have it all together. The decorations, the fancy food, the polished music. But for many of us, the mess of our lives doesn't seem to line up with the rest of Christmas. And what I want you to know is that the Christmas story is quite messy. It's quite jacked up, for lack of a better word. The best party stories, when you think about celebration, right? The best party stories usually include a little bit of mess and a ton of messy people, right? Now, I'm sure you could one-up my crazy Christmas stories, right? Probably right now you're sitting at home thinking of all these different ways. Nah, man, I've got one Christmas story that's way more insane than that one. And I get it. In fact, we all have moments probably from our past that make for a good story, but depending on the audience, it's probably not something we want to share a lot, right? We're probably not too proud of some of those stories. But here's the thing about crazy stories and fun stories and wild stories and stories that we remember. It's the characters that really make up those stories, no matter how small those characters are. Think about your favorite movie. Think about your favorite book. It's usually the small character who plays a huge role in the plot line. Think about the best supporting actor, the best supporting actress in a film. Those are usually the most memorable characters of the movies, of the films that we love. You know, so many of us love Star Wars and that Star Wars universe, and it's not so much about the main plot line. We love all of the little other characters along the way that make this huge story seem so amazing. At the time we're watching it, we think, well, that's insignificant. And then as we follow along, we realize what we thought was an insignificant player in the story ends up being a very important person. Now listen, I don't know what you're going through in your life, but I know it's obviously been a hard year. That's the understatement of the century for sure. And you might feel insignificant where you are. You may feel like your life has no point. You're watching this right now. You're listening to this, and you're just running in circles in your life. Maybe you've messed up big time. You feel like God has you in time out. You feel like you're just a bit player. You feel like there are things you've done in your life that are so scandalous, there's no way anything good could or should happen to you or through you. Let me tell you, it doesn't matter how old, how young you are. It doesn't matter how far away you may think you are from God. God is in the business of taking people who seem insignificant and messy and using them for big purposes. And at the heart of the Christmas story, there are tons of dysfunctional characters, people who don't have it all together, people who are messy, who on the surface it looks like there's no way they could be used for something good. And yet, as we see, God ends up using them in the biggest ways. And in fact, it's our big idea today. If you don't get anything that we talk about this morning, I just want you to chew on this thought that dysfunction doesn't disqualify you from His story. Dysfunction doesn't disqualify you from His story. But I don't want you to just take my word for it. We're going to jump back in to the genealogy of Jesus. So as you know, in the series, we're looking at this timeline of all these characters, these family members, these relatives of Jesus found all throughout Scripture in Matthew and Mark and Luke and John. Luke, he traces the lineage of Jesus through his mother Mary, and Matthew traces Jesus' lineage through his earthly father, Joseph. And so as on surface, as Pastor Chris talked about, these lists seem long, they seem boring, they seem a little dense and dull, and we often skip past them, not really understanding what it is that we're reading. But I hope as we continue to dig deeper into some of these people, you'll get the point and see how this will connect to that big idea. And so in Matthew starts off like this. Matthew chapter 1, it says this. This is the record of the ancestors of Jesus the Messiah, a descendant of David and of Abraham. And Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was the father of Jacob, and Jacob was the father of Judah and his brothers. So it's important to note, Matthew, he wrote his letter primarily to Jewish audiences to highlight the royal and messianic, that's the savior lineage of Jesus. So the Hebrew people in their scriptures, they looked for this savior king who would come to save him, and that's who Jesus is, and Jesus was to them, the messianic lineage. So Matthew wrote to really highlight that Jesus is the one that you've been looking for. Bottom line, there's a lot of references to the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament, found in Matthew, and Matthew comes out of the gate swinging. In fact, outside of a man named Moses, have you heard of Moses? Outside of Moses, there's no more well-known Jewish patriarchs than Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and David, and they're all listed here in the genealogy of Jesus. As Pastor Chris said, it's so easy to rush past this genealogy because it seems boring. It seems like it's someone else's story, but not so fast. I think we'll see our dysfunction and our mess right alongside of Jesus. So Matthew says Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac was the father of Jacob, and Jacob was the father of Joseph and his brothers. That's interesting. Judah and his brothers. Judah and his brothers. If we study the Old Testament, we know that Judah is a significant name because it's the tribe that brought us King David. He's another important guy. And it also brought us some other really important characters as we look through the scripture. But who were Judah's brothers? It says Judah and his brothers. Well, one of his brothers is pretty famous. We still name our kids after him to this day. And his story is a classic tale of how oftentimes our setbacks are just setups for our comebacks. And so let's look at that real brief. Genesis chapter 37, verse 3 says this. Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day, Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful robe. Have you heard of the story of Joseph and his coat of many colors? Maybe you've seen the Broadway play, Joseph in the Technicolor coat, right? This is where that idea comes from. Verse 4, but his brothers, what? Hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of them. They couldn't say a kind word to him. One night, Joseph had a dream, and when he told his brothers about it, they hated him more than ever. So Judah and his brothers, and we're finding out that these brothers include a guy named Joseph. Now, you're going to have to hang out with us for our next series called Detours, where we're going to spend about five or so weeks, going deep into the story and the life of Joseph. So we're not going to unpack all of that today. This is just a little sneak peek, but we're going to go through Genesis 37, 39, for we're going to go through all this great story of Joseph in our next series. You definitely don't want to miss that. But let's keep reading. Verse 23 of Genesis 37. So when Joseph arrived, so Joseph is walking out to his brothers. They're out in the fields tending their flocks. So Joseph shows up, and his brothers ripped off the beautiful robe he was wearing. Then they grabbed him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. Then just as they were sitting down to eat, they looked up and saw a caravan of camels in the distance coming towards them. It was a group of traders taking a load of gum and balm and resin from Gilead to Egypt. Verse 26, Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain by killing our brother? We'd have to cover up the crime." I think that's sad and a little humorous. I picture this kind of like maybe a dark comedy. Here they beat up their brother, throw him into a well, and then they say, you know what? Judah steps up and says, you know what? Let's not kill him because then we'll have to cover it up. And I'm thinking, why don't you just not kill him because he's your brother? Why don't you just not kill him because it's murder? He's thinking, let's not kill him because who wants to deal with the blood and the guts and digging and all the lies? We don't want to deal with all that stuff. So verse 27, Judah has this plan. He says, instead of hurting him, let's sell him to those Ishmaelite traders. After all, he's our brother, our own flesh and blood. And his brothers agreed. Again, that's so sad. So tragic, so ironic. Hey, let's get rid of him. We hate him, but let's not kill him because we don't want the hassle of having to cover it up. Instead, let's just sell him into slavery. After all, he's our brother. Man, with brothers like Joseph had, who needs enemies, right? With those kind of brothers. So think about that story, though. Who is the good guy in the story? So often our heart, we go to Joseph, we think about Joseph, you know, poor little innocent guy getting beat up by his brothers. But who's the good guy? It seems as if Judah is actually the one who saved the day. It actually seems that Judah, some scholars even will argue that Judah wasn't trying to avoid the inconvenience of cleaning up a murder. He really didn't want to kill Joseph, but he also didn't want to take on the other brothers. So he kind of compromised and said, hey, I got a better plan. Let's not kill him. Let's sell him into slavery. And of course, as we read in the text, we find out that that's actually what Judah wanted to do. He wanted somehow, some way, we can get him back and we can make all of this stuff work eventually. You know, that his plan wasn't truly to just get rid of him altogether. So it seems that Judah is the savior in this story, right? It seems like he's the one that wins. Bottom line, dad showed too much favoritism and Joseph was impetuous and he was a little tone deaf. He walks right into this ambush by his brothers. Can you say dysfunction, right? That sounds like some messed up family stuff going on. Some of y'all say that describes Thanksgiving in your house, right? That kind of backstabbing and fighting and all of that stuff, whatever. Joseph's story goes from insane to just, there's no words for it after this. And again, the next series we'll unpack that. But let me just give you the quick lowdown of what happened. So he goes into slavery. He's going to end up going to jail. And some stuff's going to happen to Joseph while he's in jail. And we're going to unpack that in our next series. But there's a little period of time between chapter 37, when Joseph gets sold into slavery, and chapter 39, where we see, and chapter 40, where we see Joseph in jail. There's some stuff that happens in between that, and that's where we're really, really going to dig deep. So again, remember, in chapter 37, Joseph goes from being daddy's favorite to a slave. In chapter 39, we catch up with the rest of his story. But in chapter 38, we learn more about Judah and the family of Jesus. And it's definitely an adult story. Now, moms, dads, you're watching this at home. This might be a good time to put on onechurch.tv/kids. Let your kids watch something else in a different room, right? This is where the story is gonna escalate very, very quickly. It's going to get PG-13 here very quickly in this story, and I just want to give you that fair fair warning. I'm going to do my best to stay true to the text without giving away too much detail, obviously. But I know there may be some young ears listening, so I just want to give you that full disclaimer. For the sake of time, I'm not going to read really the whole story word for word. I'm going to give you the Carlo International version, right? You can read it for yourself. You can go back and cross-reference it and make sure what I'm telling you is true. So here's the story. What had happened was, right, you ready for this? Judah, in chapter 38, Judah gets married, has two sons. So, again, sells his brother into slavery after beating him up, throwing him in the cistern with the other brothers. He says, hey, don't kill him. Let's sell him into slavery. And then they all go back to just living their lives. They go back to living their lives. Judah, he gets married, and he has two sons named Onan. So he grows up, and he's supposed to marry a young lady named Tamar. He's supposed to marry Tamar, be engaged to her. But is a very, very evil dude. The way he behaves towards Tamar is messed up. He's evil. And so God takes his life. That's what it tells us in Genesis 38. Was evil. God took his life. So according to the custom in the ancient Near East, and this is a custom many of us, we can thank God that we don't have today. In this custom, in the ancient Near East, when a brother is married and he dies, his next brother in the family has to essentially take that wife, take his brother's wife, so his sister-in-law, gross, right? He has to marry his sister-in-law in order to continue the family line. And you know what I'm talking about when I say continue the family line. That was the culture. So is evil, dies. So the next up to bat is Onan. And according to custom, Onan is supposed to marry Tamar, continue the family line. Spoiler alert, Onan does not fulfill his duties. And it's a very, very graphic part of the scripture. I'll spare you those gory details. But the bottom line is Onan does not do his job, and God takes his life too. I promise you, I'm not making this up. So Tamar is now disgraced, and Judah is like, oh, well. And this is where the story goes bonkers. You're like, you mean the story's not bonkers yet? Yes, this is where the story goes absolutely off the rails. So several years pass by, and Judah's wife has died, and Tamar, she actually goes back home to live with her parents. She's disgraced. She's now been married twice, not been able to have kids, and it's just, or at least she was committed to be married and wasn't able to have kids, and so it's just disgraced. So she goes back and lives with her parents, and she finds out that Judah, her father-in-law, is coming to town. So Tamar comes up with a plan. Now, I don't endorse this plan, but it's in the Bible, and we shouldn't try to whitewash the Bible, and we shouldn't try to make very hard stories in the Bible palatable to our 21st century ears. So I'm just going to keep it real, and I am not going to pretend to try to explain away to you the dysfunction that's about to go down in this story. Is that okay? I mean, you may think that I'm supposed to have all these perfect answers and all that, but I'm just telling you, I read this story, and I go, what in the world is this all about? So Judah's wife passes away. Tamar finds out Judah's coming to town. So Tamar decides to dress up like a prostitute. And well, she, how can I say this? She connects with Judah on credit. Like I told you, this story is absolutely bonkers. She dresses up like a prostitute, has a connection, has an entanglement with her father-in-law on credit. He doesn't have any money, right? So he gives her some of his personal items basically as a down payment. Like, hey, I'll hit you when I come back to town. Go ahead and hold this staff. Take this signet ring, you know, this stuff, and hold on to this. So after the deed is done, she goes back home, and then Judah comes to make payment. And the people, like, they say, what? There's no prostitute here. What are you talking about? And rather than be embarrassed, Judah just ends up kind of sulking away to not look foolish. He had no idea that that prostitute was Tamar in disguise. Y'all might be tuning in right now, and you're like, what in the world kind of church is this? Talking about prostitutes and father-in-laws and all. Look, I'm just telling you, this is what's in the Bible. This is part of the story, right? He had no idea that it was Tamar in disguise. So some time passes, and you guess it. What happened to Tamar? She is pregnant, right? So Tamar is pregnant. Pregnant by Judah, her father-in-law. Judah, her father-in-law, is the father. Now, this absolutely sounds more like an episode of the Maury Povich show or maybe the old school Jerry Springer show. You're thinking there's no way what's happening here is in the Bible. And I'm just telling you, man, it's in there. It's nuts. This is all what happens while Joseph is sold into slavery. So all of this goes down between Genesis 37 and 39 here in Genesis chapter 38. So Judah, he finds out, word gets back to him. Hey, your daughter-in-law, the one who married Onan, the one who was with Ur, you know, your two sons, well, she is not married to them, obviously, they did, and she is pregnant. And so Judah finds out, and he demands to have her killed for committing such a terrible sin. Now, seriously, the dude who picked up a prostitute after selling his brother into slavery is now all of a sudden in the position to throw stones? And before we write that off and say, oh, well, that was just culturally the way they treated women back in the Old Testament, let me just pause and speak right now into 21st century life. Ladies, I am so sorry for all of the times you've had to experience this type of double standard hypocrisy, especially from the church. It makes me angry for you, and I'm sorry if I've ever treated any of the women in my life like this, or if I've ever been a part of any foolishness like this, where someone who is so clearly broken and dysfunctional and messed up and full of sin, like Judah, now, the first time he finds out about someone else's flaw, now he wants to throw stones and beat her up. You fast forward into the New Testament, Jesus is confronted with this same story when a woman is brought to him who'd been caught in adultery, and they're about to stone this woman, and they want to find out what Jesus has to say. And of course, it's a phenomenal story where Jesus draws in the sand and basically says, whichever one of you has never sinned, go ahead and throw the first stone. And the gospel writers tell us that from oldest to youngest, they put down their stones and walked away. And it's just Jesus and this woman. And she says, you know, and he asks her, where are all your accusers? And she said, they left. And he said, I don't accuse you either. Go and sin no more. That's the way of Jesus, right? We don't bring condemnation to people who mess up. Back to this story in Genesis 38. Judah is bringing straight condemnation. Tamar's pregnant. What? He freaks out. Self-righteousness, double standard, and he comes at her. And again, in our 21st century cultures, ladies, I'm so sorry if you've had to deal with this. And just because that type of behavior is not new, it doesn't mean that it should be normal. This is where we all say we must do better, right? Treat everyone much more grace than what we see happening here. Now, let me ask you, you ever encounter someone who was so self-righteous, and then a few years, you discover they've had some big, bad, dark secrets? You know what I'm talking about? They're constantly beating people up verbally about sexual sin. We see this in the news, right? Some politician constantly beating people up about sexual sin, and then you find out, oh, they've been having an affair for 15, 20 years, right? Or you find out about some preacher who's always preaching about alcohol is sin and you shouldn't touch any of this stuff, and then you find out, man, he's been addicted to pain pills for 15 years and he's addicted to pornography and all this, right? And so self-right, always beating up, harsh towards people, and meanwhile they're holding on to something inside. Or you know someone who always guilt trips people about not serving in a local church, or they guilt trip you about your behavior, and then you discover in their life, man, they've never tithed, they've never given an offering, they don't volunteer, they don't serve, they're just quick to point out what everyone else is doing, right? That's self-righteous behavior, and self-righteousness, it just stinks, right? It's terrible. Not just because of its hypocrisy, but because, you know, it's just human nature. We tend to project our junk onto other people. We tend to deflect our own issues, and especially in church context, it comes out like self-righteousness. And Judah is being super self-righteous. And one thing that Andy Stanley says about self-righteousness is self-righteous people who are overtly self-righteous like this, they usually have something to hide. The louder people get sometimes in their self-righteousness, there's usually something that they are hiding on the inside that they don't want everybody to know about. And that's definitely what's happening here in this story. Let's get back to the story. Verse 25 of Genesis 38. You guys still with me? Good, good. Verse 25. As they were taking her out to kill her. So this is poor Tamar, right? They're taking her out to kill her. She sent this message to her father-in-law, to Judah. The man who owns these things made me pregnant. Look closely. Whose seal and cord and walking stick are these? And in verse 26 of Genesis 38, Judah recognized them immediately and said, she is more righteous than I am because I didn't arrange for her to marry my son Shelah. And Judah never slept with Tamar again. So, remember what the custom was. One son's married, he dies, next brother marries. If he dies, next brother marries. And it's Judah's responsibility to make sure that Tamar is taken care of, that the family line continues. And it took this crazy scheme. I don't know what Tamar was thinking to go through and do this. Again, I don't want to try to make this a nice squeaky clean story. I'm just telling you, it's dysfunctional at the highest level. This is messed up. Culture aside, this is a dysfunctional story almost every single step of the way. And Judah, after he's confronted with his self-righteousness, he's confronted with his hypocrisy, he realizes, you know what? She is more righteous than I am. I'm the one who's wrong in this situation. And Judah never sleeps with her again. I told you, this story is absolutely crazy. If I were Jesus, I'd be like, Matthew, did you really have to mention the part about me being related to Judah and Tamar? Like, bro, you couldn't have left that out, right? You know, all the cool stuff you got to see me do, all of the life we experienced together, homie, and that's the part you want to tell everyone, right? And if you have a friend like that, always put your business in the street. You're like, bro, come on. Thankfully, I am not Jesus. And thankfully, Matthew did include this story of dysfunction, because it's so important for us to see how God operates. You think, Carlo, a story about a father-in-law sleeping with a prostitute who was actually his daughter-in-law because God killed the two other brothers for some pretty nasty things that they did. What in the world does this have to do with Christmas? Like, how am I supposed to listen to O Holy Night after being shocked and scandalized with this kind of talk? Hang with me for a little bit. Let's go back to that genealogy. Here's what Matthew 1 says. This is the record of the ancestors of Jesus the Messiah, a descendant of David and of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob was the father of Judah and his brothers. Verse 3, Judah was the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. So Tamar has these sons from Judah. Notice that it doesn't say Jacob was the father of Joseph and his brothers. See, Joseph is the poster child for overcoming adversity. Joseph was righteous. There's no record of Joseph sinning against God overtly. There's no record of Joseph sinning against people. Joseph is about as good as can get. He gets a little funny and shady towards the end, paying back a little bit of vengeance on his brothers. But in the big scheme of things, Joseph is, he's the victim of multiple injustices. Joseph is the hero. The last 25% of the book of Genesis is all about how God raises up Joseph, and Joseph sets the stage for so many amazing things that happen. We look to Joseph as the ideal, but the reality is God often uses what is real to accomplish the ideal. And in this instance, God chose Judah over Joseph. God chose Judah over Joseph. My friends, this is what the grace of God in action looks like. Paul tells us in Ephesians that it's by grace that we've been saved through faith, not by our own works, lest anyone could boast. And if there's ever anyone who could say, I have nothing to boast about when it comes to my own righteousness, it's Judah. And yet Judah is the one God chose. Listen to the last words of Judah's father, Jacob, as he blesses all of his sons. We're going to fast forward almost 11 chapters into the Bible. In chapter 49 of Genesis, here's what Jacob says as he has all of his sons around him. He says, Judah, your brothers will praise you. Genesis 49:8. Judah, your brothers will praise you. You will grasp your enemies by the neck. All your relatives will bow before you. Judah, my son, is a young lion. a young lion that has finished eating its prey. Like a lion, he crouches and lies down like a lioness who dares to rouse him. Verse 10, the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from his descendants, until the one to whom it belongs, the one whom all the nations will honor. There's so much in that verse. We really don't have the time to dig through it. But it's important to note a couple of those things in that blessing. First of all, he says, Judah, your brothers are going to praise you. Judah, your relatives are going to bow down before you, which is amazing because most of this story starts with God giving Joseph a dream where Joseph dreams his brothers are going to bow down before him. Spoiler alert, that does happen, but in the end, it's Judah who God says through his father, Jacob, no, everyone, the nations are going to bow down from your family. And of course, he's talking about someone very, very important. Judah wasn't the firstborn. That was Reuben. But Reuben was disqualified for some things he did. And Levi and these others, they were disqualified. Judah was not the godliest. Like I said, that was Joseph. In fact, it's not logical, historical, or even for moral reasons that Judah would get such a powerfully prophetic blessing from his father. There's no logical, historical, or moral reason for Tamar to be grafted into the lineage that would include Israel's greatest king, David, and it would also include the King of Kings, Jesus, whom all nations would honor. It's not logical, historical, or moral to think about how those things happen. But you know what? It's theological. It makes God sense. Because God, when things don't make sense, when things aren't logical, sometimes we got to remember, hey, this is a theological issue. God is the one who by his grace made this happen. Matthew 1, Judah was the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. And 35, 36 generations later, we get to verse 16 of Matthew 1, and it says, Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And Mary gave birth to Jesus, who is called the Messiah. See, the Christmas story doesn't begin in a manger. It doesn't begin with angels and shepherds. It doesn't begin with Mary and Joseph. It certainly doesn't begin with presents under a tree or carols or all of the polish of the holiday. And all throughout the genealogy, we see that Christmas begins with messy people. It begins with dysfunction. It begins with a story that sounds more like a Cinemax movie than a Bible story. You know what I'm talking about? Why is this included for all of history? I think it's because God wants you to know that no matter what your dysfunction is, God wants to use you in his story. More than what God wants, I'm telling you, God can use you in his story. He can use you to bring about life change, to introduce people to this awesome hope and truth that we know that God is for us, that Jesus is alive, that we can have eternal relationship with God because of what Jesus has done. We can have abundant life in this life, and God can use you to share that message with everyone. Where are you at in the Christmas story? Have you believed that you're too young, you're underqualified, you have a deep, dark secret? Do you have this thing like Judah? You're struggling with a mistake and no one can find out about it. Like Tamar, are you isolated in shame because you've been used, you've been abused, you've been abandoned by the people who should love you and care for you the most? Have you believed the lie that just because you're a little rough around the edges, you can't be used of God? Or some of you, you know, you're like, I can't even come into a church. I can't connect with a church because I'm not good enough. I don't know enough of the Bible. You know, listen, I struggle with so much of this stuff in my own personal life, and I'm telling you, I know what it's like to think, how could I be of any help? Or worse, someone else, you know, holds us to their standard and to make us feel like we don't belong. Yet God, while telling the story of how Christ came into the earth, he chose to tell us about a group of people who were full of dysfunction, and they were full of mess, and they ended up playing a huge part in this Christmas story. And here's what's great. You and I, we have a part in that story too. Your life is a part of God's great story. In fact, people like us, people like you and your dysfunction, you're the point of the story. Jesus came to save us out of our mess. He came to save us out of our dysfunction. He came for the messy, and he uses the unlikely story to make a better story. So how do we live it out? What do we do with this awesome truth? I think there's just two quick things that I'm going to pray and we're going to be done. The first thing is this: if you find yourself in a mess in your life, if you find yourself, you know, just full of dysfunction and jacked up, could you do me a favor? Do us all a favor. Don't make your mess messier. Don't make your dysfunction more dysfunctional. We did a series called Address the Mess years ago, and I remember one of the lines in that series was, don't add water to your flood. If your basement's flooding, don't go in there and add more water to it, right? So think about the story we just heard. Judah, when he realized he was caught and he was wrong, he repented. He acknowledged his self-righteousness. He stopped dead in his tracks as he's headed down, getting ready to wrongfully kill this young lady. He says, wait a minute, she is better than me. I'm the one who's wrong. He doesn't make the mess messier. And it says he never sleeps with her again, right? It's kind of what Jesus told the woman that he caught. Hey, go and sin no more. Don't make your mess messier. So if you find yourself, you're stuck in that dysfunction, let me just encourage you, don't make it messier. And second thing, and this is important for all of us, we need to go to the messy. The person that's dysfunctional, the person that's messed up, the person that, I love how my friend says it, you know, my pastor friend Mike Burnett, he says, look, when you see someone and your first instinct is to roll your eyes at the thought of that person, he's like, that's the very person Jesus came to die for. That's the person that God wants. The person that annoys you the most, that person in your life that you can't stand, that's where you have to press in. You got to dig deep and you got to say, no, now is the time to love like Jesus in that mess. That Jesus didn't, he didn't call us to just go to the people that look like us and act like us and that we get along perfectly with. And I'm not saying invite toxicity into your life. You can go on oneChurch.tv, watch our series, add, follow, block, share. That'll tell you about some healthy boundaries in relationships. What I'm saying is that God's mission is always to go after those stuck in their dysfunction, stuck in their mess. And this week, we get to do that. This week, I encourage you, reach out to your messy friend. Bring them to church with you this week, or bring them to your house if you're able to do that, if you're comfortable doing that, and y'all watch this together, or text them the link of the sermon series and say, hey, watch this with me. Let's do a watch party, whatever it is. Reach out to them. Connect with them. Finish this year strong by reaching out to the messy. Here's what I love about God, that in spite of our brokenness, in spite of our propensity to wander and make mistakes, he is always for us. Our dysfunction doesn't disqualify us from his story. Pray with me. God, thank you so much that you loved us so much you sent your son that we might have life. Help us to trust you. Right now, wherever we're at, wherever we're sitting, wherever we're viewing this, however we're engaged right now, I pray, God, that you would search our hearts and help us to acknowledge that, God, we are not all that. We don't have it all together. And yet, in spite of those things we think that disqualify us, God, none of that changes our status as sons and daughters with you if we've said yes to Jesus. And if we have not yet said yes, we can do that right now and say, God, forgive me, help me, I'm going to follow you, I'm so sorry. And God, you receive us with arms wide open, you take us in, you love us, and you do the good work of making us better. You do the good work of growing us into who you've called us to be. You don't save us, God, from our mess and dysfunction to keep us there. You save us to push us on to something even better, the great part we can have in your story. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus. Thank you for this great story. Help all of us to share this good news that you have come for all, a savior for all mankind. That's such a great news, such a great story. Thank you that we get to be a part of it. In the strong name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you again, Pastor Carlo, for the awesome message, as always. And if your family is still looking to continue the service together, go to onechurch.tv/kids to keep worshiping together. I'm so thankful for our kids ministry. And if you've been with One Church for a while and you aren't completely connected, make sure you text Connects1C to 97,000. This is where you stay in the loop. We'll pray for you every Monday morning. Any updates, this is the way that you can be connected to One Church. And now we thank you for joining us again, and I hope you have a great week.